The Bible says God so loved the world. Are you there with me, someone? The Bible says God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were still sinners. The objects of the grace of God are sinners who don't deserve his grace. We go on to the operations of his grace. Hallelujah. Verses 4 to 6. What did he do for us when he met us in our sins? What are the operations of the grace of God? Notice what the Bible says. Verse 4. But God. Remember, as you read from verses 1 to 3, okay, the Bible says we were dead in trespasses. We were living according to the course of this world. We were actually living according to the will of Satan. We were following the lust of the flesh and the mind. We were by nature children of wrath. And then verse 4 says, but God. Hallelujah. But God. This is who we were. But God. Lost in sin and sorrow. But God. Destined to die for our sins, but God. But God suggests an interpolation. It suggests a God intruding into time. It suggests the condescension of God. It suggests an intervention of divinity in humanity's plight. Oh, dear brothers and sisters, but God. So what did he do? The Bible says, but God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love, with which he loved us, because of his great love. It means that God's love is the motive for God's actions of grace. Love is the supreme ethics. And the origin of love is the heart of God. The nature of God is love. Now the Bible says he loved us because of his great love. What did he do because of his great love? The Bible says because of his great love with which he loved us. Okay, his great love with which he loved us. Notice what it says again in verse number 5. Even when we were dead in trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. For by grace you have been saved. Verse 6 says, and raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Oh, brothers and sisters, notice now, but God. You need to look at your neighbor and say, but God. Hallelujah. But God, because of his great love, notice what he did. Because of his great love, God resurrected us from the dead in sin. He resurrected us from death in sin. And then because of his great love, he raised us up together in heavenly places. Because of his great love, he made us to sit with him in heavenly places. The church didn't get that revelation. It's worth dancing about. Hallelujah. Ah, the Bible says because of his great love, God resurrected us. Remember in chapter 2, verse 1, we were dead in sins and trespasses, but he resurrected us. The Bible says because of his great love, he raised us up together in heavenly places. Because of his great love, he made us to sit down with him. Now you will get excited if you really got what Paul is talking about here. Paul is simply saying that because of God's great love, he made Jesus to die for us substitutionarily. This is the doctrine of substitutionary atonement. This is the doctrine of the vicarious sacrifice of Jesus Christ, that all of the great facts of the gospel have us to identify with them. Now, you got to get this point. Jesus died for our sins. We were dead in sins and trespasses. Jesus was actually resurrected. And the Bible says we are quickened together with Christ Jesus. You didn't get that now. What he's saying is that when Christ rose from the dead, the same spirit that lifted him from that grave is the same spirit that quickens us from dead works. So we are quickened together with Jesus Christ. We are partakers of his resurrection, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. Hallelujah. That's not all. The Bible says he raised us up together with Christ, meaning that he did not only resurrect us, he ascended us. Hallelujah. We experience the resurrection. We experience the ascension with Jesus Christ. But that's not all. After resurrection, there was ascension and there was coronation. The Bible says he has made us to sit together with Christ. When Jesus went to heaven, he was coronated. In other words, he was enthroned as king. Eternal, immortal, invincible. He sat as the king of the universe. And what the Bible is saying is that he's not sitting alone. Hallelujah. He's not sitting alone. We are seated with him in heavenly places. Hallelujah. We are seated with Christ in heavenly places. God has made us to be positioned with Christ in heaven. That is the operation of the grace of God. That's what God's grace has made us. Now let's go on. We don't have time. The objective of his grace. The objective of his grace. What is the origin of the grace of God? The heart of love. Who are the objects of the grace of God? Wicked sinners who are dead. What is the operation of the grace of God? To quicken us, to resurrect us, to ascend us, and to coronate us. So what is the objective? Why did God have to do this? Notice what the Bible says in verse 7. That in the ages to come, he must show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. This is interesting. So God did all of these things for this reason. God did all of these things. He resurrected us. He ascended us. And he coronated us so that he would do what? He will show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. By the way, you know what that means? God saved us so that throughout eternity, God will display us as the trophies of his grace. He saved us so that he will take us from one end of eternity to another end of eternity and say, this is my trophy. I have won these trophies of my saving grace. The trophies of the grace of God will be the redeemed. Hallelujah. God saved us so that he would display us as his trophies. You know, when these athletes win a tournament, win a particular match, and they've gone to, they have won the victory, and they are given the trophy. You know the trophy? That which is the result of their energy on the field. What is the first thing they do with the trophy when they get it? Come on, talk to me. They lift the trophy as a display. When you get to heaven, when I get to heaven, God's going to get you up and say, listen, universe, this is my trophy. This is the trophy of my grace. This is the trophy of my grace. This is the trophy of my grace. All through eternity, God will celebrate the redeemed as the trophies of his grace. So angels, the Bible says, long to look into these things. The glory of Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, my dear brothers and sisters, that's why God saved us. So we are looking at the God of grace. Now let's close to this message with the grace of God. Verses 8 to 10 deal with the grace of God. We have seen the God of grace, now the grace of God. Notice what the Bible says in verses 8 to 10. Take note of that which is underscored for. Take note of it, because there are two occurrences of for in verses 8 to 10. The Bible says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Verse number 9, not of works, lest anyone should boast. This is interesting. This is telling us, number 1, about the purpose of salvation. Verses 8 and 9 are about the purpose of salvation. The word for, which is used in that text, is important because it is suggesting purpose. The word for actually begins chapter 2, verse 8. it also begins chapter 2, verse 10. That word for is used as a function word to indicate purpose, to indicate, something meant for studying. It is used as a function word to indicate an intended goal that is left to be fulfilled, or the goal of a particular thing. And so he says, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus. That is in verse number 10. But in verse 8, he says, for by grace you have been saved. Now this is important. For by grace you have been saved. Look at this little, thing here. It is a diagram. I tried to diagram the text. For by grace you have been saved. That is A. Why? So that no one will boast. Are you there with me? For by grace you have been saved. So that no one will boast. That tells us the purpose of God's saving grace. Why did God save us by grace alone? So that no one will boast. Why did God save us not on the basis of how many Sabbaths we have observed, so that no Adventists will boast? Why did God save us not on the basis of how many commandments we have kept, so that no Adventist elder will boast? Why did God save us not on the basis of any work that we have done, so that all mouths will be shut? God saved us by grace alone, so that no one will boast. You need grace plus nothing to be saved. It is grace alone which serves as the means, the basis of our salvation. Hallelujah, people of God. I said grace alone. Grace alone. Grace alone is the only means of our salvation. So the purpose of salvation is to shut the mouth of everyone. No man's work is meritorious. Even faith in God is not meritorious. The only merit is the cross of Christ. What can wash away man's sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. We are saved by grace alone. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now let's go on, brothers and sisters. God has a purpose for saving us. But he also has a purpose for the saved. He has a purpose for the product of his salvation. Are you there with me? God is wiser than the manufacturers of the world, the architects and the designers and the inventors of the world. Every invention has a purpose. So how can God's salvation not have a purpose? How can God's creation not have a purpose? So God saved us by grace alone, so that every mouth will be shut. And God saved us, according to verse number 10. It says, for, hallelujah. Notice now, verse 8 says, for by grace we have been saved. Verse 10 says, for we are his workmanship. The first four is about the purpose of salvation by grace. And what is the purpose? So that no one will boast. The second four is about God's purpose for the saved. What is his purpose for us? The Bible says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. There is a twofold purpose in that text. The first is, the Bible says, for we are his workmanship. The word workmanship actually means we are his masterpiece. The word workmanship actually means we are his work of art. The word workmanship actually is from the Greek, which is pima. And pima is the word from which we get poetry. We are the poetry of God. We are the poetry of God. God has presented us as his sculpture. He has presented us as his portrait. We are the workmanship of God. We are the poem of God. We are the masterpiece of God. In fact, hallelujah, someone, when you look at that text, the word his, which is a possessive pronoun. His is actually taking primary and emphatic place in the text. When you read the Greek, it is not "for we are his workmanship." You know what? It is not "we are his workmanship." In the Greek, it is his workmanship are we. In the Greek, they use word order to show emphasis. So for instance, if I want to emphasize market, in a sentence, my wife goes to the market. If market is what I want to emphasize, in the Greek, I would say, market, wife goes to. Or market goes to wife. The emphasis is on market. In the same way in our text, the text says, his workmanship we are. It shows possession. So why did God save us? We are saved to be his. The trophies of his grace are also his masterpiece. Those who are saved are the product of God's greatest act in history. So we are his. The answer is, God saved us for himself. God saved us for fellowship with him. God saved us for intimacy with him. God saved us for communion with him. God saved us for relationship with him. We are saved to be God's masterpiece. But there's another reason why we are saved. The Bible says, we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for what? Good works. God saved us also for good works. Hallelujah. He saved us for good works. So what is the purpose of God for the saved? God saved us for himself and unto good works. The first is relationship. The second is reflection. Is the church still around? God saved us for himself. That is relationship. God saved us for good works. That is reflection. Good works are actually God's works. You didn't get that, brothers and sisters. Good works are God's works. For it is God who works in us both the will and to do his good pleasure. Good works are not meritorious. Good works are reflective of the relationship that we have with God. We are not saved by our works, but we are actually saved unto good works. Are you there, church? Are you there, church? We are not working in order to gain salvation. We are working as a gratitude for salvation. Are you there with me? Is the church still around? Stop keeping Sabbath to go to heaven. Stop being holy and doing all the things that you do because you're working for your salvation. There's one group, there's a church where people go on missionary journey and you ask them, why are you passing around in your black and white and you are sharing Bible tracts and all these things? They say, we are working for our salvation. Are you kidding me? For by grace alone, we are saved. Hallelujah. For God alone, we are saved. And unto good works, we are saved. Hallelujah. As we conclude, my dear brothers and sisters, this is the message for this generation. This is the third angel's message in verity. This is the message Adventists are to be proclaiming. That is why more than anything else in the world, I am fascinated that you called me to talk about grace and not nothing else. Are you there with me? I am excited. Notice what Ellen White says in Review and Herald, September 3rd, 1889. She says the present message, justification by faith, is a message from God. It is from who? From God. Because I know some legalistic brothers and sisters will start saying, where is this Liberian guy coming from with this message? My dear brother, it's from God. Anyway, says it is from God. Then she says it bears the divine credentials, for its fruit is unto holiness. If you want people to live holy lives, start bullying them with your legalistic messages. Preach the grace of God to them, for it is unto holiness. Hallelujah. 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 Ellen White says, we own everything to grace. Free grace, sovereign grace, grace in the covenant, ordained our adoption, grace in the Savior, effected our redemption, our regeneration, and our adoption to headship with Christ. Everything is grace. I'll close with this story. An old Indian, after living many years in sin, was led to Christ by a missionary. And so friends asked him to explain the change that he was experiencing in his life. Reaching down, this man picked up a worm. He picked it up, he had it in his hand, and he got some flowers. And he put the dry leaves on fire. And then he took the worm, he placed it in the middle of those leaves, and the fire began to actually swell, and the fire came closer and closer and closer to the worm in the midst of the leaf. And as his friends were looking intently, wondering what he was doing, this man rushed back and thrust his hand into the midst of the fire and grabbed the worm, lifted it up, and put it back in his palm. He said, I am the worm. Yes, yeah, the fire. It is the wrath of God. Grace is God coming to grab me from the path of wrath, the path of destruction, the path of condemnation. And he has redeemed me. Redeem how I love to proclaim it. Redeem by the blood of the Lamb. Redeem through his infinite mercy. God's child and forever I am. Hallelujah. A man called John Newton was a slave trader. He had a terrible childhood. This man actually lost his mother when he was just 6 years old. He spent years fighting against authority. He was a wayward guy. Later, he abandoned his crew in West Africa, and he was forced to be a servant to a slave trader, for he was eventually rescued. Now, on the return of that voyage, he nearly died, but he was preserved by God. This man went through and through an experience. He saw his wickedness, his promiscuity, his unrighteousness, his ungodliness, his filthiness. He saw all of these things. And eventually, my dear brothers and sisters, this man saw the saving grace of God. He was redeemed when he surrendered his life to God. Then he began to think how God saved him from the shipwreck. How God saved him from his abandonment in West Africa. How God saved him from the dangers of hell. And this man wrote these words. The prodigal had never been so exemplified as by myself. He said, I see no reason why the Lord singled me out for mercy, unless it was to share by one astonishing instance that with him, nothing is impossible. I want you to know, no matter how far you've gone in sin, No matter the degree and extent of your unrighteousness, no matter the extent of your waywardness, there is grace for you, my friend. There is power in the blood of Jesus. If you are listening to me via the internet, I need you to know, my dear friend, that until the church of God, until all saints of God are saved to sin no more, the blood of Jesus will never lose its power. And so John Newton wrote the song, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see." Stand up wherever you are, please. Want the song leaders to join us up here as we sing this song. "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound." And today I want you to just appreciate God for his grace. Amazing grace. Extravagant grace. Marvelous grace. Sing that song with all your heart.
Amazing grace.
Amazing grace.
How sweet.
How sweet the sound.
The sound
that saved a wretch like me.
Saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now
I sing that first stanza again. Amazing grace. The first stanza again. Amazing grace. Yes, Lord, that saved a wretch like me.
That saved a wretch like me.
I once was lost.
I once was lost.
But now I see.
I'm found.
Was blind.
Was blind.
But now I see.
But now I see.
Now let's sing the last stanza. When we've been there 10,000 years.
When we,
oh yes, Lord.
We've been there
10,000 years.
10,000.
Oh yes, Lord.
Years,
bright shining as the sun.
Bright shining as the sun.
With no less days to sing God's praise.
With no less days to sing God's praise.
Than when we first began.
Than when we first began.
Listen to me. Do you know the meaning of that particular stanza? That's a powerful stanza, Pastor. The guy is saying, when we have been in heaven for 10,000 years, are you there? When we should have stayed in heaven for 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we have no less days to sing God's praise than when we first got to heaven. Even after 10,000 years, God is still the one who takes the glory for our salvation.
Amen.
Adventists will take off our crowns. You know, Adventists always say, you know, the amount of stars on your crowns is as a result of how many souls you have won. Even if you have 10,000 stars, the Bible says we take off our crowns and drop them at the feet of Christ. What are we saying? Amen. We are saying we are here, not by any work that we have done, but by your grace.
Amen.
Do you appreciate the grace of God? Bow heads as we pray. Father in heaven, I thank you in the name of Jesus for such extravagant grace. I thank you for such incalculable, immeasurable grace. I thank you for this marvelous, magnanimous grace. I thank you, God, for an efficacious grace. Grace that will always be greater than sins. We thank you, loving Father, for your message of grace. I thank you for the appreciation of this grace you have ignited in our hearts. All through this week, may we understand the magnitude, the depth, the width, the height of the grace and love of God. We honor you, Lord. We give you all the glory for answered prayer in the name of Jesus. Let God's people say amen. Amen. Now, as you take your seats, I have an appeal for you. This camp meeting, I want to recommend, listen and listen very well, that this camp meeting be an evangelistic camp meeting. That would mean that you will bring people to this meeting. Are you there with me? Invite your friends, your families, your loved ones, everyone in this community, reach to doors and homes and invite people to listen to the marvelous message of the marvelous grace of God. Is that your commitment? Say amen. Is that your commitment? Is that your commitment? May God help you in that very good commitment. God bless you.
Amen. I believe we've all been touched by the great sermon. In the same spirit, we'll all rise with our theme song, Hymn 338. Choristers.
Let us sing. Redeemed, our love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed now, I love to proclaim it. His child and forever I am. I think of my blessed Redeemer, I think of Him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent. His love is the theme of my song. Delight to lovingly guide my footsteps and give at me song in the night. I am redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed now, I love to proclaim it is time.
Our Father in heaven, we thank you for our redemption through your blood. We thank you for being the God of grace and for making us the recipients, the objects of your amazing grace. May you, O God, make your grace to abound toward us. And may you open our understanding that we will conceptualize this amazing truth of your word. Now, may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ,
the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen and amen.
I believe we have all of us been blessed. I believe we are still desiring to receive more blessings throughout the week. And so I want to take this opportunity to invite you again and again that you may purpose to bring many other people. Those that are missing, kindly may you give them a phone call or just text them. Or just WhatsApp them. Tell them something is happening here and they are missing it so that they can avail themselves. And so kindly please, members, let us encourage many, as many as possible. Just purpose to talk to many people so that we may avail ourselves. I know Pastor Makiti is in our midst. Pastor Makiti, where are you kindly? May you please wave at the congregation. Aye. Thank you so much. Elder Uchuka, our head elder, kindly. All the time. Okay, camp chair, Elder Omurwa, where are you, please? Aye. Thank you so much. I think as we get along, we shall be able to get to know each of us as we move along. Allow me to say a few things. One of them is that we have our program with us, and so our program will be starting as early as 6. So from 6 to 7, we shall be having our morning devotion, and so I want to encourage as many of us that we may avail ourselves, that we may be blessed. We have Pastor Douglas Ohigo who will be taking us through. And so kindly, please, let us purpose to avail ourselves. From 7 to 8, we shall be taking our breakfast. Then from 8, we shall be running through the whole program. All the lessons that we have. And members, I want to let you know that we have different lessons as they are in our program. So kindly, please, may we also purpose to avail ourselves, that we may be blessed of the Lord. We have our visitors who have come to visit with us so that they can also share with us whatever that the Lord has prepared them. So kindly, please let us come so that we may be blessed together. Remember, parents, you need to bring your children. This time we are doing what we call family camp meeting. Family camp meeting where we have our children with us here. And so they will be running their classes. Come divine service, will all of us be gathering together as we shall be blessed together. And so parents, kindly please avail your children because their teachers will also be available for them. The other thing is that you remember we have our camp goal, and our camp goal is 3 million. And because our camp goal is 3 million, we want to encourage each and every member. Please, this is the only privilege that God has extended to us, to thank Him and to express our love for Him, that He has been with us throughout the year. Since last year we had our camp meeting up to until this point in time. And so each of us have a reason to thank our God. Remember, He says, as you come, please don't come with empty what? Empty what? Hands. So please, whatever that the Lord has blessed you with, whether it is cash or whether it is in kind, whatever that you have, just present it to the Lord. Whether it is a bull, or whether it is a goat, or whether it is a chicken, whatever that the Lord has blessed you with, kindly please, I believe as New Life, we can even do much more than the 3M. Because the 3M is just but a guide. And so kindly please, let us purpose to give so that at the end of it all, then the name of the Lord may be glorified. Remember, as we are doing all this, the glory should go to who? Not to us. Please, let us purpose that because we are saved by grace, and that all glory must go to God, that as we purpose to give, we shall return to God because we want Him to receive the what? The glory. May God bless us. May God be with us. And I want to believe that our guest speaker, that you've officially opened our committee. Okay, so it is already declared. May God bless us as we plan to attend our camp meeting. Shall we pray? Our gracious dear Heavenly Father, we come before Thee. We want to thank You that Your faithfulness has ever been with us. And so, dear Lord, we want to commit ourselves that as we purpose to attend to this camp meeting this week, that gracious dear Lord, You avail enough time for each of us. And as we gather here, that we may be blessed of the words that You prepared Your servants to speak to us. Thank You for allowing us to travel from all the way from different places to gather all of us here. May Your name be glorified. Thank You again for granting our camp meeting speakers, Jenny Masses, to be here. There are those that still are yet to come. Lord, we pray that as they travel tomorrow, may You also go with them. May they arrive safely. And as we carry through the whole program throughout the day, Father, we pray that may Your presence walk with us to the end. Lord, we want to pray that may Your mercies continue to be upon each of us. And God, we want to pray that as we have started our camp meeting and as we go through all to Friday and come Sabbath, that gracious Lord, we may look back and say, the hand of the Lord has been with us. Thank You because You're faithful, God. To this end, we pray in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you. God go with you. God take care of you. Amen.
As the pulpit party leaves, we'll finish song 108 as we welcome Jiro SDA Church for a musical item. We're welcoming Jiro SDA Church, our guest choir, for a musical item. So we're singing song 108 as we finish the session today. We'll sing verse 3 and verse 4.
Sorry, as the chorister is going to lead us, I am aware that our guest choir is going to bless us with several songs, like 5 of them. So if you so wish, please, you can stay back that we may all of us be blessed together. Remember, they have come to serve us. We need to sit and listen to them. God bless you. Thank you.
Let us sing.
The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will be my shield and portion be as long as life endures.
Amen.
mengi ya ajabu kutoa pepo na kuponya moto ana kumaliza moto ushuke walakini msitishe watafanya mengi ya ajabu kutoa pepo na kuponya moto ata kumaliza moto ushuke walakini msitishe
Yeah. tulie mmoja.